Hello friends, welcome to our channel Physics for You. And yes, here in this video we will continue the last video's concept only, which was completed half in the last video, that is Sommerfeld quantum model or Sommerfeld quantum theory. So within 1 minute we will revise what we have seen in the last video so that we'll have the continuation in proper manner, because this is what the continuation of last video only. Okay, so in the Sommerfeld model, First of all, we'll see how it is different from the Drude-Lorentz classical theory. So Drude-Lorentz theory has taken the help of, or has distributed the particles in metal according to the MV distribution. But Sommerfeld model Sommerfeld said that no, we have to derive, or we have to distribute those particles in accordance with the Fermi and Dirac distribution. So by considering that the potential energy well we have considered, that means we have considered an electron present in a metal can be treated as a electron trap in a one dimensional box, first of all, for simplicity, and then we will have the same analogy to the three dimensional box. So if we are talking about a one dimensional box, and then according to Sommerfeld theory, or according to Sommerfeld, the box or the electron or the particle cannot come out of the box at the room temperature, and therefore the consequence of this is leads to that the potential inside the box or inside the potential well must be zero, and as compared to that potential, the potential outside the box is infinite. Okay, so this is how looks like our one dimensional box we have considered of length L. And outside we have considered the potential barrier of V0, and for the electron present in the box, it is very hard to reach up to or come out of this by overcoming this barrier. So that's why we say the V0 is a very large potential as compared to the V is equal to 0, means potential inside the box. So for such case, we have first of all written the Schrodinger equation, and by applying that inside the box we have potential 0, so we reach up to the Schrodinger equation in a simple manner, and we have written, or we have taken one solution to that, and by resubstituting that solution in the Schrodinger equation, we got two different roots. One is for plus I omega, and second one is minus I omega. And then after substituting those roots, so final solution to the Schrodinger equation when the particle is present in the box within the range 0 is less than equal to x is less than equal to L, we got this as the wave function. Okay, so finally we got this as the solution, and that is nothing but our wave function. So we have to apply the boundary conditions to that solution, but before that, this is what the case inside the box only. So let us try to find, or we have already tried to find what happens outside the box. So outside the box, we have different Schrodinger equation, it will be different because V0 is not, or potential is not zero here, and moreover it is greater than the energy of one particle, and that's why in reverse manner we have written the Schrodinger equation, and similarly we have written the solution for it by taking these two roots. So this solution tells us that the wave function is going to be increases and increasing and increasing, and as x tends to plus or minus infinity, wave function and ultimately the probability tends to infinity, but which is not possible, probability must be finite, and it leads to the consequence that two solutions in one region, that means to the left hand side of the box C4 is 0, and to the right hand side, that means it is greater than L position, C3 is 0, and therefore we have two different solutions. So now we have up to this we got three different solutions. If you remember, inside the box I will write here equation number 4 is the solution. Okay, to this side, that means when C4 is 0 means x is less than or equal to 0. So here we have equation number 8 as a solution, and here we have equation number 7 as a solution. So at these three cases, I will name it as equation case first, case second, and case third, or we can consider it as position first, second, third. So three different positions, and we have three different solutions, that are 4, 7 and 8. Now we can apply the boundary conditions. So boundary conditions are nothing but there are some properties of our wave function, and by using those properties we can establish the boundary conditions. So boundary conditions means at the boundary, means at this interface, at x is equal to 0 and at x equal to L, the wave function must be continuous. Must be continuous means it should vanish there. So that is what the first boundary condition, at x equal to 0 and x equal to L, psi should be 0. And similarly at the boundary, the first derivative of wave function, that means the slope of curve of the wave function is also, or wave function must be continuous. The slope should be vary continuously, and that means dou psi by dx or d psi by dx must be 0. So let us use one of them. So we will use the first boundary condition, little bit simple, no need to take the derivative. So applying first boundary conditions to the equation 4. So if you remember, or shall we recall the equation 4? Just a second. Yes, it is equation 4. So in the equation 4, we have to apply the first boundary condition, that is at x is equal to 0, psi should be 0. So x equal to 0 means here cos 0, c1 cos 0 plus c2 sin 0, and psi is also 0. So applying the boundary condition, first boundary condition, I will write the equation here. Yes, already I have written. At x equal to 0, psi should be 0. And yes, whatever we have there from equation 4, psi is equal to 0, c1 cos under root 2m e y h cross square x, but x is 0. Therefore, c1 cos 0 plus c2 sin 0. But we know that sin 0 is 0, but cos 0 is 1. Therefore, we got this first value of the constant c1. So, c1 is equal to 0. Now again apply the first boundary condition only, but at the second boundary to the equation 4 only. So at second boundary, at x equal to L, psi again must be 0. So there we have this as equation 4, and in this equation 4, psi should be equal to 0 when x is equal to L. So instead of x, here I have written L, x is equal to L. See, it is already x, but now at x equal to L. So, but we know that, just we found that c1 is equal to 0. So, let us substitute this value of c1 is equal to 0. And finally, we got left hand side is 0. So, c2 sin under root 2m e by h cross square into L. Okay, right. Or we can write this c2, if we go right in the opposite direction, it will go to the denominator, and again it is 0. So, sin under root 2m e by h cross square into L is equal to 0, equation number 9. Okay, so the sine of some angle is 0, that is what we got here. Okay, sine of some angle is equal to 0. But we know that in the standard form, sine n pi are 0, sine n pi are always 0. That means sine of n pi is equal to 0. Even it is 0 for 0, sine 0 is 0. But n, when we are talking about the one dimensional case, this n should not be 0, that's why I have started from 1, n is equal to 1. Okay, so here sine of some angle is 0, but and sine of n pi is equal to 0, therefore these two angles must be same, or we can write sine of this term and this term must be same, because right hand side 0, 0. Or now we can take, after taking the sine inverse on both sides, we can write under root 2m e by h cross square into L is equal to n pi. Or just rewrite this and we can have the energy equation like this. Means, okay, after taking, or I will write here, on squaring on both sides. So after taking square, this square root will go, and L square on right hand side, N square pi square. Just rearrange, we want energy. So energy E is equal to N square pi square H cross square, because this denominator H cross square will go to the numerator on other side. So N square pi square H cross square divided by 2ml square. Moreover, h cross is equal to h by 2 pi, and this gives h cross square is equal to h square divided by 4 pi. Okay, so that 4 and this 2, 4 to the 8, right? And yes, now we can cancel this pi square, moreover, because here h cross square divided by 4 pi square will also get cancelled. Sorry, here it should not be there, pi square is not here. So simply it is n square and h cross square, sorry, not h cross, again it is simply h square, n square, h square, because this pi square will get cancelled with this pi square. right. So finally, what we got is that this energy is proportional to n square, because h is constant, yet is 8 is constant, m mass of the electron is constant, and l, once you have a fixed crystal or once we have a fixed box of length 0 to l, whatever may be the value of l, that is also going to be fixed. Only the changeable thing is n, which is varying from 1 to infinity. Okay, so if we are talking about this L value, again this L is also in our hand. If the value of L is larger, then energy will again be smaller, because energy, or we can say L is in denominator. If L increases, this value also decreases, and ultimately the energy levels will be very very close to each other. That means I can write, I will draw here. So if it is a one dimensional box, and if I am talking about very smaller value of L, or means the length of the box, then the energy values will be, for n is equal to 1, n is equal to 2, n is equal to 3, and so on. Okay, I will draw this diagram below with respect to that graph only. So simply here, what I am saying, if L is very large, or L is sufficiently large, then the energy values will be close to each other. So analogously, now we can write for the three-dimensional box, because one-dimensional is not the actually real case. We have to apply that to the, it is only for the understanding purpose. One-dimensional is only for our calculation purpose. Once you got some results from one-dimensional, then we will apply that, those results analogously to the three-dimensional. So here now it becomes easy to apply everything to the three-dimensional. So in three-dimensional case, that is the real case. Okay. We have all three-dimensional crystals. One-dimensional crystals are only the hypothetical things. So if we are talking about the three-dimensional, that means it is a cube of length L. Okay, so this is simply a cube of length L, side length L, and it is now a crystal, and in which we have one particle trapped within each, and yes, inside the this cube we have potential V is equal to 0, and outside the potential is infinite. And for such case, we can directly write the solution to the Schrodinger equation, that is our wave function, as A sine nx pi x by L into sine n pi y by L, again sine nz pi z divided by L. So this x, this y, and this z are suffix, this nx, ny, nz, those nx, ny, nz are nothing but the positive integers. So this is the solution to the Schrodinger equation in case of three-dimensional case. So that is what I said. Already we have talked about one dimensional case, and now directly we will have the analogy. Okay, no need to calculate anything. So the corresponding energy also we can write in similar manner, since for one dimensional we have n square h square divided by 8 ml square. So here, simply here, n square h square divided by, sorry, here again pi square should not be there. Just if I am writing h cross square, then pi square is there. Okay. So here simply nx square plus ny square plus nz square h square divided by 8 ml square, analogously simply. Okay, or we can write in simple manner for first dimensional, for x nx square h square 8 ml square total energy. Okay, I will write one more step here. Then ny square h square divided by 8 ml square plus nz square h square divided by 8 ml square. This is for with respect to x axis, this is with respect to y, and this is with respect to z. So we can take all the remaining things common, only in the bracket nx square plus nyz square plus nz square. Okay, and now we will see, that's what I said initially, or we have written here, energy is directly proportional to n square. Okay, so n is what, the number, energy level. If n is equal to 1, it is ground state, n is equal to 1, first excited state, and so on. So we will draw a diagram in which we can show the graph between energy and the value of n also. And here only I will draw the diagram, or I can write it as in terms of, means we will just take this as a, sorry, again here it is pi square, it should not be here. Okay, here it is, n square h square. So if we consider this as a unit, in unit of this. So finally we got that. That's why I have written on y-axis en in units of h cross h square 8 ml square. So simply here I can write, or I will draw the first of all the potential well, and we will draw the energy levels up to n is equal to 5, so that you will understand. So it is n is equal to 1, then n is equal to 2, n is equal to 3, n is equal to 4, and n is equal to 5. Okay, it goes to infinity because we have infinite potential well. Okay, right. So n is equal to 1. So what will be the value of energy in units of h square divided by 8 ml square? So n means 1, n value is 1, so 1 square 1, so it is only 1. Okay, for second we can write 2 square, it is 4, then it is 9 in units of h square divided by 8 ml square, remember, then it is 16, then it is 25. So whatever these numbers I have drawn in this graph, right, on the x-axis we have taken these numbers n values, and on the y-axis we have taken energy values in unit of this h square divided by 8 ml square. That means we have considered this is equal to 1 in units of, that means that is equal to 1. So we got these values at 1, it will be 1. So at n is equal to 2, the value will be 4. So here somewhere it is less below the 5. Then at n is equal to 3, value of energy will be 9. So it is little bit lower at than 10. So here is the point. This is for the 16 and this is for 25. So it continues. So it is what we can say, the parabolic nature of the energy with respect to the n values. Moreover, this n is equal to 1, this state is called as ground state. This is known as first excited state. Now next onwards, second excited state, third excited state, again fourth excited state, and so on. So these are, so n is equal to 1, that means the energy of ground state, shall I write here, E1. So n is equal to 1, so n square will be 1, so it is simply h square divided by 8 ml square. This is called the ground state energy, ground state energy, and all other next energies will be in multiple of this ground state energy, and that's why we can say the energy spectra is a discrete energy spectra. So whenever we have the discrete energy spectrum, or discrete thing, anything that comes into the quantum mechanics. So quantum mechanics only gives the birth to the discrete things, right? In classical mechanics, we generally talk for the continuous things. So the quantum mechanics tells us that the energy spectra is a discrete, and therefore this model is also known as quantum model, or simply the Sommerfeld's quantum model. Okay, so yes guys, this is all about the Sommerfeld quantum model or quantum theory of metals or free electron of in the metals. I hope you got the things, and if you have any problem you can post in the comment box. Otherwise, if you feel this is value addition to your knowledge, then like this video. For more such videos, subscribe to our channel, then press the bell icon so that you will get the notifications of our next videos, and yes, share with your friends who are interested to learn the physics. So yes guys, we'll meet in the next video with new concept. Till then, you please take care and keep learning. Okay, thank you so much. We'll meet in the next video very soon. Thank you.